like inside the gym. So stabilization, phase one of the OPT model, really, really, we're just now pouring the concrete and we're laying the foundation for all of the progress that we want to set further down the road. Now, inside of the stabilization level, our primary focus is going to be to get people moving better, all right? Because obviously if we can, let's say for example, get someone to get into a better position inside of the squat, that's going to allow them to get stronger and hopefully challenge the body, which regardless, whether someone is looking for body composition change, fat loss, strength gain, we need them to be able to challenge their body with intensity. But if they're not moving well, it's going to be hard to do so. So inside of this phase, we're not going to find a significant focus on load, meaning the overall weight that they're utilizing. Even if we were to look at, although you probably won't do that many one rep maxes with your clients, if we were looking at one rep max percentages, you're going to be staying like 40 to 60% of someone's one rep max because we're going to be doing slightly higher volume, meaning we're going to be doing slightly more repetitions and at a much, much slower tempo than most people are used to. So a couple of words that should stand out to you on this slide, not only from a test-taking standpoint, but just from an understanding of what we're trying to achieve. First one is going to be optimum neuromuscular efficiency. So it sounds sexy, but it's like, what does that mean? Optimum neuromuscular efficiency. What this means is actually getting our body better at sending the right signals to the right muscles to create the right movements. So although for many of you guys are in this course because you already are avid lovers of exercise, squatting might not seem that complicated to you. You're just like, all right, let me sit my butt back and down, right? Pretty simple. Now, think about, maybe you played basketball, maybe you didn't. Think about something like a free throw. A little bit more coordination, there's a little routine to it, fluid motion that has to happen. For some people, neurologically, a squat could be like a free throw. If they've never done it before, it's like learning a new skill. And when you start to think about exercises that way, all of a sudden your approach towards how you load it, the speed at which you do it, all those things start to change. So optimum neuromuscular efficiency really just means, in layman's terms, training your neurological system to better communicate with your muscles so that we're sending the right signals and we're getting the most contraction of those muscles we're trying to use. In the squat, that means we are hinging at the hips first, all right? So that way when we get to the bottom or whatever depth they're achieving, we're engaging the glutes, putting those hips back, all right? Utilizing the quads, the hamstring, the glutes together, the coordination of the hip and the knee bend. It takes time for people. When you really start to break down what's happening in the body, you can start to see that each of these exercises is kind of like a skill. So how we achieve this, as you look inside the material, this is gonna be through much slower tempos, all right? Tempo has to refer to the speed of movement. So if you think about the average way that people approach the gym, I don't think a lot of people think that much about how fast they're moving. If anything, sometimes they're just trying to get it done with, right? So it's like, just go as fast as possible. But what we'll find is that stability and speed have an inverse relationship. The faster we move, the harder it is to stabilize. So when we have clients in this phase one, and really honestly, as you have people working out in their first 3 to 6 months, the best thing you can do, slow it all down. Slow it all down. All right. And so as you go through and coach, and we'll talk more about this, obviously we're going to coach and communicate how to squat, but we're going to make sure that they're squatting at the speed that we want. And if you look inside the NASM material, it seems a little crazy. This is really slow. Let's look at a push-up. So they give you a 4-2-1 tempo. That means 4 seconds down, which is like slow motion, 2 second pause, isometric contraction, 1 second concentric. And we'll get to more of those words as well. Those might be new terms for you, eccentric, isometric, concentric. But what it means is we're going much slower on the downward phase. We're pausing at the bottom and we're going back up at a normal speed. And the benefit of slowing these things down, especially in these first couple phases, because it'll translate even over into our endurance, our stabilization endurance phase, muscular endurance, is you literally just have more time. You've got more time for your body to process. Where is everything? Where is it at? Can I make corrections as I'm going down? What does it feel like? So we're really training that neurological system. And not to go too much more on this, but just to give you guys an example, there's a really great classic study that's been around, talked about for decades now. It's called the Broomstick Study. And what they did, and without getting too much of the detail, they took two college-age group of men. Neither group had really worked out that much in the past. And they tested their bench press max, all right? And they said, okay, at the beginning of the research study, what's the max amount you can bench press? And then what they had one group do, they had one group do what we call a progressive resistance training program, meaning that based upon their max, they did reps and sets that were percentages of that weight over an 8-week period of time. All right, very traditional way towards trying to increase strength. And as you would think, at the end, they had a significant improvement in their strength in that one rep max. Now the other group, they literally only trained, they still maxed with weight, found their max, then they trained with a broomstick. They trained with no weight. They trained with tempo, and they trained with isometrics. So some strategy and slow controlled contractions, isometric contractions, and then being more explosive. And they saw almost the same significant increases in their strength, which sounds crazy, but it just goes to show you that so much of someone's initial gains in strength are going to be neurological. Now, no doubt, early on in the program, people still may get sore, there still may be some hypertrophy, some strength happening because of the load, but just keep in mind, the best thing we can do is take our time when it comes to adding intensity, adding load, because for a lot of people, there may be some real strong neurological challenges that their body's trying to adapt to. All right, so keeping in mind, that's gonna be a primary focus, and that's probably a simplification of this optimum neuromuscular efficiency that you're gonna see throughout some of the material. And what we'll find in this is the way that we progress this phase is another buzzword, proprioception. It's gonna be a proprioceptively enriched environment. Now, what does that really mean? We'll continue to talk about what proprioception is, but our body is a master at bringing in information, all right? Visually, you guys are bringing in information right now. For me, I'm standing without my brain thinking about it. My body's getting information about where my weight is, pressure on the ground, heat. We get all kinds of information all the time. And so inside of this phase, our goal is to utilize changes in position, changes in stability, to challenge our body, right? We want our body to get better at using and deciphering this information. Speed does that. That's one of the reasons that we slow everything down. Whether you're doing that perfect 4-2-1 tempo or you're just focused on slow eccentrics, isometrics, normal concentrics, that's gonna help us because proprioceptively we've got time to get that information. And then over time, rather than just adding weight, we may change the position. Maybe instead of a bilateral squat, we start to do some more split stance lunges and those types of things because now my body's gotta use more of that information. There's more of a challenge with my balance and stability. So that would be an example of proprioceptively enriched environment. Don't get confused. I know when I first started to go through this information in my mind, I thought maybe that means everything needs to be like a single leg balance exercise, which has its place as we get into the balance chapter, but it's gonna be pretty hard to change people's bodies when that's all we're doing. So a proprioceptively rich environment just means playing with those positions, stabilization, still slowing things down and progressing people slowly throughout this first phase.